Welcome to Flop Soup, a podcast about pop culture and flop culture. I'm Justin, and I am joined here today by filmmaker and writer and dear friend, Thom Hilton. Thom, say hello.
Hey Justin, what's up?
Hi, Thom. Thank you for joining us. Dear listener, Cassandra is still out, just frolicking around Europe in various places, flaunting her heterosexual union. And for today, we have a wonderful conversation spanning many topics, which we will get into shortly. But Thom, first, I have to ask you the question, how are you flopping this week?
How am I flopping this week? Justin, I'm very, very lucky right now that I have a short film that I made, which is playing here in Portland.
Okay,
And
plug, get right to it,
a
get to the
plug right immediately.
promo.
When someone asks you, what's your flop? And then you go into a plug, it's going to be bad news.
I tried to make a thing that's really important to me, and then something really bad happened. So,
So I was really, really lucky. It's been kind of playing all over Portland, Oregon, which is where I am right now and where we made it. But it's been playing for the past 4 days at this really great independent movie theater here. And it was programmed in front of this movie called I Used to Be Funny, which is this new
okay.
indie movie starring Rachel Sennett. And I think the programmers, they saw the word funny, and then they assumed that it would pair well with my movie, which is funny. It's a very light little queer comedy. The Rachel Sennett movie, however, is like a 2 hour long, extremely traumatic PTSD story about this au pair who is babysitting this young girl and experiences a very traumatic event. And it resembles in many ways like Anatomy of a Fall and Spencer.
I've seen your beautiful, incredible film, Matinee Baby. Again, watch it. Does not sound anywhere remotely close to anything happening. And I used to be funny.
No, and I went and saw it on Friday night, and I saw my short, and kind of nobody laughed. So I knew the audience was maybe keyed in for something else. And then
Okay.
it's like, it was literally like 115 minutes or whatever of Rachel Sennett driving around crying while Adrian Lenker is like, who's this sending your mother and kids? Who's like,
And you're sitting there just like, oh,
fuck, fuck, fuck.
marketing.
But I'm extremely lucky and grateful to have my film
So
out
grateful, right?
there.
And shout out to the programmers for all that they do. They're so busy.
Shout out to the programmers. Shout out to the programmers who asked me if there was any connective tissue between the two movies before I saw the movie. And then
Wait,
they.
because you couldn't have seen I Used to Be Funny before.
No, I didn't have access to it. I said, this will be a really fun pairing because Rachel Sennett and I were both on the Las Culturistas live show 5 years ago.
Wow.
Justin, how are you flopping this week?
Flopping this week because a new season of Couples Therapy just premiered and it's so good. But I am so enamored with just Orna and everything that she is. I have been watching a lot of Couples Therapy and I love how Orna does things and has conversations with these people who are probably not paying for the therapy because they're on the show or they're paying like thousands of dollars a minute. I can't really tell, but I
Wouldn't
am
that be so great
finding
if the budget of the TV show Couples Therapy came from the clients?
they're like, this is Showtime, baby. We don't really know where the funds are coming from.
Showtime has like neg beyond negative money.
It's like Hulu by way of Showtime or Showtime by way of Hulu, and it's
Wait,
a whole
Hulu?
scheme.
I thought Showtime was already by way of Paramount Plus. Like they're going
It's
every channel
this
possible.
is in different areas, okay? But I am watching it despite all the obstacles, and I'm just finding that I'm so being Orna in like the conversations I have with people. I'm being like, so like, what is behind that feeling? And like, what are you bringing into this space and this conversation and like all this stuff?
What do you mean by that?
I kind of like wish I became a therapist is really what it is. And I think the show reminds me, I'm like, oh my God, being a therapist is so cool. Maybe I should go into like hundreds of thousands of dollars of debt so I could do this too and then have a show as well.
First of all, you don't need to be a therapist just because every gay guy in your life already is one.
Yes.
You're Cassandra's therapist, so that basically counts.
Podcasting is therapy, okay? Do you want to watch?
I don't watch reality television, really. I had a bit of an addiction when I was younger to Big Brother.
Anything that I would have put in your realm at all.
No, not at all. And I would pay for the 24-hour live feed. I would just sit and watch them.
What does that mean?
Middle school and high school, every summer, all summer.
Damn.
Yeah. If anybody knows, back in the day, Jesse Godders from Big Brother was like major in my gay development.
Okay, and shout out that experience.
Shout out that, and also shout out, that might come around later in one of our big discussions of a certain article.
Bodies and what they mean. Yeah.
But yeah, and since then, not really. I tried going to Beverly Hills season one. Mostly because every boy that I think is cute watches Real Housewives.
That's such a problem for you.
It's like really, really, really bad. What else? I mean, I watched Drag Race, but that's not really reality television because none of them are reality.
No, that's as far removed from reality as you can be.
I know what couples therapy is because I've like heard about it on podcasts. God, please cut that. That's so depressing.
I've heard about it on podcasts.
There's nothing worse than the idea of like, yeah, I spend my time listening to two other people talk about stuff that I don't know anything about.
Oh my God, I know. That's me. Now that I'm like so into Celebrity Book Club with Stephen and Lily.
Do they talk about books and then you haven't read the book, but you listen anyway?
Absolutely. Or I barely know the person sometimes too. Like I'm just like, here we go. It's for the noise to rattle in my head sometimes.
I listen to like a lot of movie podcasts where they will cover a movie that I haven't even watched.
But you get something out of that, and that's what's important, even if you don't know what it is and you can't name it.
Yeah, I get parasocial relationships.
Yep. And that's also what Flop Soup is trying to offer the listener, if you're still with us. But yeah, I'm flopping this week because I'm like watching a show about therapy and being so like, I want to be a therapist now randomly, which I will never do because going back to school for that is a crazy move. Next, we are going to get into our quick flops, which I am going to kick off right now with Chipotle Boys, who are running rampant in the streets of New York City. But who are these boys? According to the New York Post, Chipotle boys are young men who order from the chain restaurant 5 to 7 times per week. That's like almost every day of the week. And they are dominating the culture right now, according to the New York Post, which always has its fingers on the pulse of New York culture.
I need to say something about this. Chipotle lately has been flopping. Like if you...
Yes. Okay. Yes.
If you watch Gym Talk, if you watch like food TikTok, everybody's just like, Chipotle is over. So okay. When I saw this article, I was like, this is a plant. This is a concept. Chipotle Boy is a fake thing that was created by a Chipotle PR person to try and get the brand virality again. And it's working.
Because here we are.
I don't know like anybody in my life who still eats Chipotle. And I say still because the people who did have been so traumatized by it that they will never go again.
Soggy veggies, like stale rice, you name it. It's there right now. But I do know that there were Chipotle boys at one point, but we're now insinuating is that they are no longer.
Yeah, it seems fake to me. It seems fake and gay to me. And I do think that Chipotle also went downhill after they were on And Just Like That last summer.
I think they were already on the decline, and Just Like That may have also been part of this marketing plan where it's like, let's try to get these random gay guys who are still watching And Just Like That, and then also let's try to keep the gym boys with Chipotle boys. Like,
it's possible. I live in New York sometimes, and I love to go to the Equinox at Rockefeller Center.
Crazy bitch.
I see a lot of lunch culture, and I see a lot of the bags that are being walked with. I do not see Chipotle bags often. I see Chick-fil-A raising
for sure.
Names. Like the fuckboys are on their chicken game, not Chipotle. And also Sweetgreen and like Dig In are ever more relevant forever.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like people tried to imply that there was like some kind of sweet green decline, but like it still very much is there.
Yeah, it is still very much there. Sweet green, though, I also recognize has been doing a lot more like influencer push stuff lately.
Yeah, so do you think Paul Mescal got a sweet green check for that one random picture of him standing on a street corner with a bag? Like,
absolutely. Also, what you said, sweet green check, like they paid
a
him
sweet green bucks. Check.
Like you get 8 salads for standing on the street corner. Yeah. And I just always think about like do you know the VIP list girlies?
Of course.
Yeah. Like they love to do a video where they go to sweet green.
And I didn't know that about them. I only see them when they're at like fucking like Carbone, Miami or something.
Dustin, I need to tell you about the time that I had a job interview at Carbone.
For the Patreon that doesn't exist.
I would get a cease and desist from Carbone.
Many such cases. You heard it here first. Chipotle Boys influencer marketing, paid promo, don't believe what you hear. Okay. Next up on Quick Flops, Chris Brown got stuck suspended in air during a concert in Newark when the singer's wires appeared to malfunction and he was left, quote, flapping agitatedly above the stage.
Flapping agitatedly is my
flapping agitatedly
descriptor.
Pink said, you will never find me in that situation.
I will say, on Entertainment Tonight, they were like, Chris Brown gave no air a new meaning.
Shut up.
Which made me laugh. It made me laugh a little bit, but then I was like, it's one of those jokes that's so porous where it's like, if you think about it for more than a second, you're like, no, wait, he was very air.
Yeah. He was so air.
Air.
Yeah, so air. I mean, to Chris Brown, I guess, like, maybe just fly less or just focus on what's happening on the ground, I guess. I think we should just leave that realm to Pink.
I'm sorry, I just said the name Pink and started laughing.
Next up, earlier this week, a, quote, angry Noah Schnapp was, is it, do you say Schnapp or Schnapp? What is your preference for
it? I say Schnapp just because it sounds worse.
Schnapp.
It might be Schnapp. I didn't look it up. I mean, Schnapp is like schnapps, right? That kind of makes
Right,
sense.
True. It does. He was kicked out of New York City club The Palace after begging fellow clubgoers to take tequila shots with him and getting, quote, aggressively wasted.
This is a really rough story for The Palace, who I guess was just feeding a 19-year-old tequila shots, and everybody around him, who I assume were also probably 19 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Noah Schnapp is a disaster. But he's...
Oh, yeah.
It's so interesting because we haven't really had, like, a disastrous child star... Who's also gay in a while. Like, I feel like disaster child star is so 90s culture. Mm-hmm. But Noah Schnapp really sucks. He, as Joe said, he is a full snake.
Yeah, he says, like, Zionism is sexy. That's, like, his stance.
Yeah, that's really, really rough. And also, he's a big advocate for ghost kitchens. He sells, he has, like, Noah's...
Oh my god, he has a chicken! Yeah, or is it chicken?
Yes, he sells chicken strips through a ghost kitchen on, I think, Uber Eats or something.
Oh no, and ghost kitchens, like, ravaging communities nationwide. Like, we don't support it.
He's just a real flop when it comes to the Stranger Things kids, who are all finding their own stuff to do.
Right. And I know everyone wants to shackle Millie to being a flop, but, you know.
Yeah, but she also is, like, she's becoming a woman. She got married. She can get a movie made and lead it, which is something that
yeah.
could never do. Finn Wolfhard is, like,
no.
way more successful. The what's that other one?
ranking the Stranger Things kids, a podcast.
Kate Matarazzo was just on Broadway in Sweeney Todd. So like they all have jobs, and then Noah Schnapp he sells chicken strips on your phone. I don't know.
We don't know. Closing the door on Noah Schnapp, just simply uttering his name has taken us to really dark places. Next up, the quote-unquote health soda Poppy, which claims to boost gut health, is being sued for misrepresenting its health benefits. According to research, You would have to drink like 4 cans of the soda per day for 3 weeks straight to see any gut health benefit. But at that point, you would have consumed so much sugar that it would have canceled out any health benefits that would have been provided to you. Also, just noting, Poppy's like, we are going to defend our good name, but then they're also changing how they're branding the cans at the same time already by selling them on Amazon, and they no longer have a slogan about gut health, so they're kind of also backpedaling the gut health thing. Very interesting. I will be looking out for a class action to join, though, at some point. That sounds nice. A Poppy check, maybe, in the future.
It's bound to happen.
But I will say these scare me, because they just showed up in every store one day and are everywhere and are all different colors, and I can't even like perceive them.
Wait, what scares you? The rebranding or Poppy itself?
Poppy itself. I mean, it's just they come in droves, like the number of them. They just show up and they're everywhere.
No, wait, when you told me that you were going to bring this up, the one and only comment that I had on it is, I am scared to drink Poppy. Like, I don't like a soda that advertises itself as medicine. It's, and also
then that is what 2024 is. This soda is medicine.
The idea that it will like change what goes on inside
your gut. Your microbiome. Like,
I don't want that.
No.
I'm still like, I feel like we're all still dealing with collectively what kombucha did to us in 2014. And 10 years have moved on and we're back to this.
And everyone also had a friend who like made their own kombucha, which was also like, okay.
Everybody had a friend. I live in Portland.
Oh my God. You're right.
Everybody had every friend.
Every friend in Portland. I just want to be able to drink a fun drink that doesn't do anything to me. I don't even want it to do something good or bad. I just want net neutral, net zero. I just want ground zero for my gut, you know?
Yes. Maybe if Poppy was real, it could have helped me. A sensitive tummy boy.
Many such cases.
I'll never know.
We'll never know. But we will be joining the class action when it does drop. Next up, is somebody going to match his freak? Armie Hammer broke his silence on the cannibal allegations after 3 whole years on, you guessed it, a podcast. He told the, quote, Painful Lessons podcast, people called me a cannibal and everyone believed them. Do you know what you have to do to be a cannibal? You have to eat people. How am I going to be a cannibal? Yeah.
He said that when he was being canceled, he felt like he had to cover his head and protect his neck. And my first thought was, I assume that's what a lot of the women in the Cayman Islands also have to do when he gets off of work from selling timeshares, because they don't want him to bite their necks. Because
not my pretty neck. Cannibal.
This is a comeback that we really didn't need. There's still a lot of stuff that's ongoing here. There was just like a story about his wife, I think a month ago, about how she too is now also living in the Cayman Islands. Like, it's all still very shady and confusing to me.
Yeah.
My boyfriend had never seen Call Me By Your Name before. And so we watched like 2 months ago. And I was like, it is kind of nice in a way that he was never good in a movie.
It was like an easy, like, okay, wipe my hands clean, goodbye. Like,
it's like the best, it's the best, easiest type of person to cancel, where
right, he's gone, you don't think about it. Who cares?
Even in a good movie, you're like, oh, fuck that guy.
Like, yeah, it's like, what were you even bringing here that like anyone else could bring? Like, yeah, what you're saying is so true. And that's like, what a celebrity does now is, if things are still kind of in progress, they'll go on a random ass podcast you've never heard in your life. Like, what is the Painful Lessons podcast? It's like for celebrities who got canceled to kind of like start the rehabilitation journey. Who knows? Podcast being used for evil.
I will say, I watched the highlights reel kind of compilation of what he said on this podcast while I was watching the Tony Awards, specifically during the performance of Jonathan Groff doing Merrily, We Roll Along. And weirdly, it like synced up in a really beautiful duet.
Wow.
Maybe I'll make that for you and you can edit it in.
Yeah. That would be great. Yeah. So Jonathan Groff is talking. This podcast is happening.
Well, Jonathan Groff was like, hey, old friend. And Armie Hammer was like, I did not eat a woman.
But yeah, cannibal allegations, those are forever.
And also it's just like really legit dark things too. That's what I hate about a celebrity comeback like this, is that they always pick on the thing that's easy to be like, well, mm-hmm. that's ridiculous.
Right. It's like the abuse is like, okay.
This is also my problem with like everything Ariana Grande has done in her the past year. It's like,
oh,
and music video where it's like, here's a bunch of people saying shit about me. And it's all stuff that actually like nobody is talking about.
Yeah. Everyone kind of already moved on and forgave her for it. Yeah. Yeah. It's true.
It's just like they never bring up the stuff that's actually bad because it's not part of a comeback narrative. It's so fucking fake. Anyway.
Yeah. I love that you feel that way about her. I would love to talk more about that with you.
I have no patience for Ariana Grande.
That's incredible to hear. There's so few cases.
John Travolta is allegedly crushing on co-star Kristen Davis on the set of their new movie. Source says he is totally smitten and that Kristen would definitely be receptive, but she won't make the first move. So hopefully, John can get his courage up. And I said, John can't get his courage up because John can't get it up for women.
Have you seen that? I think it was a tweet or something. It was like some gay guy was like, oh my God, I was just working out at the gym at like 3 a.m. and like this guy came up and introduced himself and it was John Travolta. And everyone's like, that is cruising.
My favorite ever Joan Rivers moment is when someone asks her, if you could sleep with any gay guy. Oh, it's Andy Cohen. Andy Cohen's like,
Joan Rivers, if you were a gay man, what famous gay would you have a one night stand with? Cowboy Cobra wants to know.
Current or past?
I think anything.
John Travolta.
Oh.
No question.
I just think it's so, so, so funny because gay people in the closet always pick the gayest women to pretend they want to fuck.
I was going to say, from the end, just like that cast.
Charlotte?
Even of the Sex and the City women, you pick Charlotte. Like, this is a plot. It's a meta plot.
It's less believable than if there was a dating rumor of him and Cynthia Nixon for some reason.
Totally, totally. Like, absolutely. Oh my God, it's crazy. What? Because who was that other gay? Oh, I mean, Hugh Jackman and what's her name?
Hugh Jackman is apparently dating Sutton Foster.
Okay. I mean, I don't know what you think about Hugh Jackman, but...
Well, I believe the word on the street, which is that he's dating Anthony from Queer Eye.
Yes, that's much easier for my palate to, like, accept. Okay, next up on Quick Flops, we're going to talk briefly about this GQ article that came out, which is titled, Everyone is on Steroids. And it starts off with the question, why is everyone on steroids now? So apparently everyone is on steroids now, and that's crazy. Thom, from your experience, is everyone on steroids now?
Here's the thing, Justin. Everyone is on steroids now, and I know this because I wish I was. I wish I was. That's how I'm popping this week.
You're like, can someone ask me if I want to buy steroids, please?
Please, please. And this comes from like somebody who my biggest motivating factor in my life is like a fear of wanting to get in trouble. And I never want to do anything that breaks the law.
Because this is illegal, as the article says. Everyone can go to jail.
It is illegal. And also, it's like so bad for your body. We'll get into that. But I want to do it anyway. Like, I have been obsessed with them forever. And the thing is it used to be kind of niche.
Then I think it was Yves Saint Laurent, wasn't it?
Like, it used to be that only, you know, people who were going to play a superhero in a movie or professional wrestlers or bodybuilders. But now, as Busy Phillips recently pointed out in her viral video, everybody is on them and everybody unfortunately looks amazing. That's the bummer about steroids, is they work. They make you so hot. And I want that. I want it badly. Mm-hmm. So if anybody listening to this wants to sponsor me.
My steroid journey By Tom Hilton. A play. What you say, everyone is getting hotter, but then you read this article and you say everyone is like losing their hair, their balls are shrinking to like raisinettes, and they have like massive amounts of back knee. So then they go into like tanning booths just to like dry the back knee, and then they get tan, and then they get leathery. And then, so what is that? How does that factor in?
Okay, I will say I do know somebody who did steroids and he lost all of his hair. It made him hotter.
Shut the fuck up. But that isn't the case for everybody, okay? Some of us have heads that are shaped in certain ways.
Yeah, I mean, you have really nice hair. I have really nice, beautiful, curly hair. I would not want to lose my hair. The balls thing, that's pretty rough. I do love...
Shout out to people that's happened to.
Yeah, like, I'm sorry to you that if that has happened to you. So, yeah, that's a bummer. Like, the side effects are really scary. What scares me more than the aesthetic ones, like those, are that your heart can, like, just completely...
burst.
Yeah.
They don't talk about that much. They mostly are, like, every other paragraph is, like, oh, my God, my balls are so tiny. And also, I go on vacation and I have to bring syringes. Like, that's, like, the main thing happening here.
This is so insane because it's, like, I get scared if I take an edible in an Uber on the way to the airport. Like, I get scared if it's already in my body.
In my body. They'll see it in the x-ray.
And people who are fully taking controlled substances onto a plane. How? I don't know.
I don't know. Like, doctor's note from, like, hell? Okay.
Oh, yeah, the doctor's note thing. Oh, my
God. Yeah, they can get a doctor's note or something being like, oh, these are, like, peptides that I think are important for this person.
And there are people who, like, do get on TRT or HRT from their doctor because they're able to, like, convince their doctor that they are doing this for health reasons, even though it's aesthetic. And I will say, I did take a step one time. Like, I got a panel done and my testosterone was low, probably because I'm gay.
And so
I shouldn't start that rumor. And so I was like, could I do a little something? But no dice.
He shut the door on you.
Yeah.
I'm sad for you. It is so all aesthetic that, like, these people are going through this hell and they're not even, like, doing anything with the muscles that they are gaining. They are just being day traders and, like, program managers with roid rage, you know?
I think that is, like, you mentioned that there's this kind of Cronenbergian element to it.
The Fly, very.
Very The Fly. And, like, that's also kind of the most enticing thing, is that steroids are almost a, like, they're the apple in the Garden of Eden. They're this kind of mythical thing of, you can look like you've always wanted to look, but all of this horrible stuff will happen to you.
Yeah, an evil genie granting you a wish.
There's kind of not a lot of stuff that actually exists like that in real life.
It's like poppy soda.
Soda. And also, it will fix your gut.
The Faustian bargain, yeah.
Exactly. But yeah, those day traders, I mean, I've seen so many of them at the Rockefeller Center gym. There's, like, all these super hot, insanely jacked Australian guys who come to the locker room and they all talk and they watch fucking, like, TV shows about stocks on MSNBC in the locker room. And then they go work out for, like, 30 minutes and they all are enormous.
Yeah.
Yeah. C'est la vie. But in the end, I think I'm the one who is flopping the biggest.
I think you are. Because you read this whole thing. And, like, at the start of it, I was like, oh, peptides, interesting. Like, I put those on my face sometimes. And then, like, and then I was like, oh, no. Like, you lose hair in certain places and grow it in others. And then your sweat is yellow and also your semen. So, not great. But then you're also like,
slay, yes, mama.
Yeah, because I'm, it's okay, Justin, this is such, like, a key part of being a man in our society is, whoa, like, is the idea that you could look at something and just go, that's not going to happen to me. That you could look at something and be like, nah, I'm different.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could handle that. And and I believe that I could. And I would.
Period. So,
for legal purposes, I'm just going to say I won't and I never will.
And I am playing a character right now. And I am in that character. But yeah, that's that little article on GQ. So next. Meghan Trainor released an album this week and was so brave to call it timeless despite every song sounding like a song she made between 2011 and 2013. Meghan is a huge flop diva queen, so we will be honoring her with a little quiz of Meghan moments. I don't know what you know about Meghan. I don't know how you've engaged with her in the past, but
I
get
will
ready.
Say, I've not listened to this new album because, not because I wouldn't have if I knew about it, but it didn't even cross my path.
It didn't even cross your path. I had to seek it out. Somehow.
I okay. know that she is fake friends with a gay dude, and I know that she thinks teachers are stupid.
Top two Trainor facts, okay? Yeah.
And she says really dumb stuff on a podcast, which is now, according to how today is going, my new favorite hobby.
Question one. Which of these is a real song on Meghan Trainor's latest album, Timeless? A. Oops. B. Whoops. C. Aw shucks, or D, G willikers.
I'm gonna play it safe and go for A.
It's B, it's whoops, it's not oops.
I think whoops is hard to say.
Whoops.
It is the chorus. It is the most said word in the song. It's just whoops. So, next question. How many songs on Meghan Trainor's new album feature a word in the title that's ended with an apostrophe instead of a G? So actually, let me give you the number of songs on the album really quick. Oh my God, there's 16 songs. Okay, so out of the 16 songs, how many of them do that? End a song with an apostrophe instead of a G. So she's saying like, you know, I'm just living it up with my girls instead of living. Is it 1, 2, 3, or 4?
I will say all of those numbers are less than I assumed.
It could be all songs. Any G erased, apostrophe, because I'm Meghan.
I think this is so great. What if there was a Becky G Broadway musical where the G was replaced by an exclamation point and it was just called Becky?
Becky! okay, four. The answer is 4. Yes.
I know it.
There we go. Yeah, it's the most. Their names are Crushin', Rollin', Sleepin' on Me, and Doin' It All for You, all okay. without a G.
Now, is the song Rollin' about drugs, or is it about rolling down a hill? Because the second option is what I believe Meghan Trainor would do.
I haven't listened to it, I will say, but I'm assuming it's more about like rolling with the punches.
Oh, I see.
She is like a musical punching bag.
Yeah. Course.
Sorry, punch-in bag. How many major publications have reviewed Meghan Trainor's latest album? Just guess a number.
Major publication. Well, nobody works at Pitchfork anymore. And and I think she probably would have gotten her team to shut down the Rolling Stone review because rolling and rolling
is illegal.
Kind of like bump against each other. But I'm going to guess 0.
Yeah, it was 0. Yeah. She got like, you know, just random publications with random names, but we're not getting even The Guardian, really. So there's that. Next question. Meghan has released 3 singles from this album so far. They're called Been Like This, To the Moon, and Whoops. How many of these out of 3 have made it onto the Billboard Hot 100?
Out of 3?
Yeah.
0.
0. Yeah. She has yet to chart. However, earlier this year, Meghan managed to chart at number 78 with a 30-second version of Jingle Bells that she recorded for Amazon. Next. In the past, Meghan Trainor has lent her vocal talents to the realm of film as well, starring in 2017's Smurfs The Lost Village as which Smurf? A. Smurfette, the main girl Smurf. B. Smurfani, the Italian girl Smurf from New Jersey. C. Smurf Melody, the musical girl Smurf. Or D. Smurf Booty, the girl Smurf with a huge ass.
I'm so sorry, Justin. When you said which Smurf, I thought you meant a Smurf who was a witch that she played.
That is option E, Smurf witch, the girl Smurf who is a witch.
Well, I don't think she can do accent work, so I'm just going to guess the first one.
So actually, Smurfette was played by Demi Lovato. Meghan Trainor was...
I always get big stars for that one.
Meghan was left with Smurf Melody, the musical girl Smurf. Who
the
is
musical
just,
girl Smurf. Yeah. And Demi Lovato wasn't the musical one. At least Demi Lovato has a really good voice.
But a bad manager, because she's not singing in the Smurfs movie, too.
God.
Megan released a song to accompany the 2017 Smurf movie. What was that song called? Was it A, Blue Ballin'? Was it B, My Big Blue Ass? C, Does Feminism Include Girl Smurfs? Or D, I'm a Lady?
I love My Big Blue Ass as the title.
I know you do.
God, it was actually so good that I couldn't even hear the rest. I became just gone mentally. I guess I'm a Lady.
Yeah, it's called I'm a Lady.
God, these answers are so depressing.
I know. last question. Meghan Trainor is currently an ambassador for a well-known shoe brand. Based on her vibe alone, which brand is it?
Brock seems too easy. And it's a brand, right? It's not like Zappos.
I will confirm it's not Zappos. Shoe amalgamation.
I think... yeah, I mean, those are really kind of it for me. I mean, she's not a Birkenstock girl. You know, I know she's worn some topsiders in her day. Give me that brand.
Skechers.
Oh my God. You know, I feel really comfortable and confident in myself that Skechers would not even enter my brain if you asked me to think about shoes.
I was going to say...
For 100 years.
He's pretending Skechers don't exist. It is Skechers erasure.
You know, Portland, I'm a Nike guy, and I certainly know that Meghan Trainor has not made her way to Beaverton, and they will not invite her.
No.
You have
no
to
ticket.
My big blue ass.
I will. Okay, that concludes our quick flops and a mini Meghan Trainor quiz moment. Next, the Tony Awards. What number was it? Was it the 77th?
Couldn't tell you, Justin.
That's okay. But they happened on Sunday. And Thom, you have thoughts.
Yes.
I do have thoughts. I did want to say, if anyone has heard me cough on this episode, I forgot
my
inhaler. It's also Justin's fault, but it's also, I'm doing kind of like Ariana DeBose drag because she has zero breath support and neither do I. Yeah. That opening number, I know you watched that at least, Justin. We'll have it edited in here somehow.
Maybe you drove here from Des Moines, spent nights sleeping in your car. Writing your great idea on the napkins as you deliver. Maybe you have to fight, but you're here tonight. You made it through, learned to give back from each setback, and made your dreams come true.
It sounds like this fake song that Patty Harrison wrote for Dua Lipa many years ago. Like, it has the vibe of...
I met you an hour ago, but I would do anything for you. Like, I would kill myself if you asked me to. I would kill myself for you.
I would kill myself if you asked me to. As soon as she starts singing, she is always completely out of breath. She has no stamina. And it's like, it's really hard to watch a host who has like zero stamina. And honestly, I think she has kind of no charisma. And she immediately starts begging. Like, as soon as the number is over, she's like, give it up for my vintage Bob Mackie dress. And then she starts going into this always happens with theater, the most vague beige shit of like, everything in the world is so bad right now.
Oh,
but art and theater are the safe place where we can change that. And I'm just like, say anything. And if you think I'm being too harsh on her, it's like, it's hard to watch, man. It's just, she deserves it. She has an Oscar. She can take it. I was thinking she's beyond cringe to me because the idea of cringe is like, it's passing, it's fleeting, but she sits in her cringe for so long. So I wanted to propose this idea that I think Ariana DeBose is crunge, which is...
Wait, crunch or crunge? Like...
Crunge. It's when cringe is crunchy. And
when it sits...
You have to go through multiple crunchy... It's not just going to pass through with a little grimace. You're going to have to sit in it for a long time. And, like, I just can't help but think about when I watched my very first Tony Awards, it was 2008, and Whoopi Goldberg was the host. And she flew in as Mary Poppins, and she said, "That's right, I'll watch your kids, but I won't clean your house." That was all you need. And yeah. Ariana DeBose could never be that simple. She never mm-hmm. could.
Yeah, it's always a whole ordeal with her.
It's always really, really awful. What else? I'm basically just going to run through some notes right now. Okay, Eddie Redmayne, did you watch this performance of Cabaret?
Okay, I did. And that left me with many questions.
It's very odd. It seems like this kind of fundamental misunderstanding of the concept of theater, which is that somebody would enjoy watching you do something. And he just throws that out the window. He says,
like, this is going to be painful psychically for you.
He says, I'm just going to do something that nobody would ever want to see. And yeah. I'm like, the whole time.
yeah. And it's like, with Ariana, at least there is a gesture towards, I'm doing some choreography. I have dancers up here that are doing it with me. There's a show happening. With him, I felt really attacked by what I saw, and it felt personal and targeted.
The thing about Cabaret that makes it good is whether you're Joel Grey in a suit or you're Alan Cumming wearing nothing, it's seedier and grittier and sexier than most musicals. And they all came out and did this version of Cabaret that was like Radical Fairy, Burning Man.
Asexual. It
was just the most gross, cringy. It was cringe. It was cringe.
It was, yeah.
I really, really did not like that. Also, I kept feeling like the threat of Alicia Keys was everywhere on this broadcast. Taraji P. Henson goes, "Now, here is best leading actor in a play." And like from far backstage, you can just hear, "In New York." Because they were like rehearsing the Alicia Keys musical backstage.
I don't know anything about that musical.
Okay, so I was lucky enough to see some really good stuff this year. I've heard it's good. The actress, best actress. But I thought, because of the way that they kind of were marketing it, that it was an original musical about Hell's Kitchen, which is where it takes place and what it's called, with new music by Alicia Keys. Like In the Heights was, basically.
Yeah.
Then you watch the preview and you're like, oh no, it's just any old musical about Alicia Keys' life where they sing a bunch of Alicia Keys music badly. And
is it a jukebox musical?
It's a jukebox, and they could not license anything with anybody else. So when they do New York State of Mind at the end, they don't have the verses. It's chorus only.
It's just in New York. Like, it's just that. Wait, that's crazy. Okay. Yes.
I will say, I love the Tonys. I love to watch the Tonys. I felt very represented at the Tonys this year because Ben Platt was there with his husband, Noah Galvin. And I've said this before, I look like Noah Galvin if you tried to regrow him in a lab like a sea monkey. So I feel represented by him.
And that's why you have eyes on Ben Platt and his new Honey Mind era also.
I've already been on another podcast talking about Honey Mind.
Okay.
I will not be discussing we'll more. Save that. Simply because I haven't listened to it. And off the record, because I'm trying to of his okay. Merrily We Roll Along seems like a scam. It costs like $400. And also, when they were doing the song, it sounded like they didn't know what any of the words were about.
Do you believe they're all like besties, like they say they are?
I really don't. I don't think
anyone could be best friends with Daniel Radcliffe. I don't think he has like a personality that you can like befriend.
You know what? I think all of them are uniquely that way. Like, and also, You're telling me that Daniel Radcliffe and Lindsay Mendez are now best friends with Jonathan Groff, a man whose previous, and I guess still current, best friend for life is Lea Michele. That means that those two people are psycho, or this is fake.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you.
This is a flop podcast, so I won't talk about things that were good, but the Illinois thing was really good.
I heard about it.
I love that. I love The Outsiders. I love Stereophonic. Very good.
Mm-hmm. Everyone loves Stereophonic.
Best show ever alert, unfortunately. My last thing that I'm going to say is when they did the musical Tommy, the performance, this little teeny twink got on stage who is playing the titular role of Tommy, and he opened his mouth. I had not seen the show or listened to the album or anything. And I was so shocked that he sounded exactly like Chloe Trost in that SNL sketch where she plays the orphan who's singing to the moon. See me! Feel me! I was like, wait, what? They're doing...
What's happening?
It was really bad. Anyway, but the biggest flop of the night, as always, is Ariana DeBose. I'm so sorry. She needs to go. And also, she like... After the number ended, she goes, that number was choreographed by me.
Please. You were just kind of like spinning.
She needs help.
She needs theater kid help.
Honey, theater kids cannot be helped.
And there we have it.
That is a lifelong terminal illness.
And there is your answer. Thank you, Thom, for letting me into the world of the Tonys, which I could not stomach this week. But I feel like I've gone on a journey through them with you. Is theater in a good place?
No.
Okay. Great. Once again, I want to say thank you so much, Thom, for being here. It was a joy. It was a pleasure. Must do again sometime. Get a microphone.
Fuck you.
But really must do it again sometime. And once again, anything else you want to plug, anything else you want to self-promo before we sign off?
My short film Matinee Baby is on tour right now. It's going to be playing in Portland, Oregon a bunch in July. It's going to be playing in Durham, North Carolina in August, and it's going to be playing virtually through the Soho Horror Film Festival in London in July as well. And so you can just buy an online ticket and stream it that way. It's a really fun 20-minute queer comedy. You'll love it. It's very like sexy too. Nah, nah, nah,
come on. Yes, can attest to that. I've watched it. I love it. It's beautiful. It's gorgeous. You're very talented. Thank you for being here, Thom. And with that, Justin and Thom are flopping off.
Bye.
Bye. But you put on quite a show.